Italian. Amani. Track. There goes your theme music right there.
Whatever the hell that was. You know what I'm saying? Roti and Poutine, we are in the building. I'll do a proper intro in a second. Let me just link all these things up to back to where we were. Zoom, excuse me, I didn't want to put them on blast like that because I love them, but here we are. Just tapped out on me right at the at the 1 minute mark. So here we are. So let me just let me just pull all the songs back into a playlist. I'm yelling all loud. Back into the playlist. Let me see what we got here. Oh man, it's gonna do a whole thing.
Oh dang. Clarice just sent me something sweet. It sounds good.
Yeah.
Yeah, it sounds great. It's very theatrical. Yeah, it's sound.
Here we go. Here we go.
Binks Beats in the house. Subconscious in the house.
Yeah, say hi to everybody real quick while we load back in, man. I apologize. It's not my fault. Technology just don't like me sometimes,
man. It's so wrong.
It's so wrong. The computer. It's totally not me. I swear, man, we had this thing. Yo, you have no idea. You know what pisses me off the most about this whole situation? Mm-hmm. I spent all day configuring everything. I had everything set up. The intro was on tight. I got new hotkeys. I spent all this time, and technology was just like, yeah, nah, we not doing that.
That's cool. cool
story, bro.
Yeah, bro. Right. Like, well done.
It would not really be routine unless it was that way.
Unless it messed up, right. You know what I'm saying? So yeah. that's what we're doing. Big up everybody in the chat. Let me just make sure this is where it needs to be, and we will be done. Just put that right there, and we're gonna pretend like none of this happened.
And
I got shit saying update complete. Ain't nobody asked for all that. Oh shit! Okay. Look at my frame rate. What is happening, bro? What is going on? All right. Hold
OPEC,
on.
ATL, what's going down?
Give me a minute. Give me a minute.
Everybody loading in, Monty. We got to go.
We loaded in. We yeah, good.
The frame rate is definitely.
Yeah. It's,
yeah,
it's
I'm looking at
glitch-tastic.
Like two frames per second on this bitch. Hold on.
Oh, is that slow to you guys? Damn. It's all right
it's
on my
catching
side.
Up now. There we go. We catching up. Oh, I had to close one thing.
It's a little better. Okay.
It's getting there. It's getting there. Code Pig, chill out with all the emojis, man. I didn't put that filter on.
They're about to hit us with the Bob Ross in the middle.
Oh, here they go. All right, man. Screw it. You can hear us, right? Everybody loud and clear. And it show everybody. Audio's good. Bink said the audio's good. And I trust that man on audio issues. So, that's exactly. Say less. We're going to get on like this. Big up, everybody. Welcome back to Roti and Poutine. My name is MC Armani Rain. That is the track MC. That is the Valiant MC. And we are in for a very, very special guest. Super mega producer, super dad, everybody's favorite homeboy, my partner in crime, and one of my favorite people on the planet, the number one Nick Wheeler, who is also known as Bro Safari.
Oh, Bobby.
What's good?
Pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me.
How are you, guy? How
I'm
you
great.
Been?
I'm great. Thanks for asking.
You got the long hair and good. Stuff.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? What's going on?
I'm hiding it. I'm hiding
well,
it.
Well, pleasure to meet you for the first time as well. You know, first.
You too.
First time,
oh.
So, like, you know.
Yep.
I feel bad all that time.
Monty's been keeping,
around,
him, keeping you to himself, you know, so, you know, we got to.
Yeah,
we gotta
he does that.
That sounds mad sus.
Wait, before we go any further, I got to point out, you've got a hype, level one hype train going on your channel, and you haven't acknowledged one of these.
Oh,
subs
I'm
yet.
So sorry. Hype train, big up. What's going on, man? Hello. Shout out to Code Pig. Shout out. Who else is in here, man? Code Pig, subscribe. Kali, what's good, man? All the people just sending their subs. I appreciate you.
Just all the subs. All the subs. You're not going to thank Bro Safari for the sub.
Oh, I didn't see who did
it. I saw it. I saw it.
I didn't I was see the first who sub. Did it. Damn.
See, I got to scroll down. Strong is in the building. Was good. Bro Safari has subscribed. I appreciate you. Thank you, Bro Safari, whoever you are out there. I appreciate the sub.
Yeah, there we go.
Yo,
we go,
if you if you're having a good time, you know what I'm saying? Like the channel, follow, hit the notification button. All right, man. We back here. Word? You just going to leave? We are off to a fantastic start.
This is the best show
this is
ever
the best,
right now.
Best episode we have done yet. It's just
oh, no.
Code said you were the master sub.
Well, first and foremost, man, how are you doing? I'm gonna start with Monty. Let us know how your day was going. How you keeping?
No,
you got a little drink in your hand.
This is just water. Hey, let's start with the guest, man. How are you?
Water.
That Philly vibe, Skookle punch. You know what I'm saying? Bro, how are you? Let's start with you.
I'm good. I mean, I don't want to ramble on about. I'm doing great.
It's fine. You're just here to talk, but it's cool. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. No, I'm feeling great.
Family good.
Everything's good. Family's good. I'm good.
Shout out to the missus and the little one and all the little peoples you got in the house, the pets and all that.
Some of them are probably
Elliot,
watching.
One of my favorite little people on the planet.
Hey.
The missus is also one of my favorite little people on the planet. I'm just kidding. I love you. How are you, Track? How you been? How was your week?
Man, I'm just mad that I just realized that all that good thing I've been doing over the last couple months, and today I feel officially fat, bro.
Aww.
So I gotta get back on my thing, man. I fell off.
That man's been doing like 7,000 steps a day. Who started? Did the wife get you on that, or you just thought it was your own? I'm gonna say it's your wife because she's one of my favorite people on the planet. So I'm just gonna assume that she motivates
you're talking
you.
To me?
Yeah, I'm talking to you.
No, that was 100% me. No, 100% me.
We gonna say it was you.
It was me. It was me. Believe me. I'm surprised she's not in the chat. But I don't know how quickly we want to jump into this quarantine situation
go ahead, have at it.
I spent like a solid 4 months just like drinking and eating pizza and just getting fat and then about 2 months ago I hit a point where I just like I had had enough. And in the last 2 months, it's just been nothing but like diet and exercise every day.
It's been great.
So, yeah.
You know, nice. For me, it was, I'll be honest, I literally hadn't ate bread in a long time until we got quarantined. And bread and butter was like the best thing on earth.
Right.
Couldn't stop eating. Seriously, man, it was out of control. Word, bro.
Eating that shit in the corner with a hoodie on, like, don't bother me. Don't bother me, bro.
I fluffed up, man. I fluffed up a little bit here. You know, I look good.
Everybody did.
No, I did too.
How about you, Valiant? How about you, Valiant? How was your week?
I put on. How was my week?
Yeah, I don't want to know how much weight. If that's what you.
I put on a lot. Okay, but it's coming off.
This
I lost
week,
a few.
All right.
My week is all right. You know, it's kind of like Groundhog Day though.
Oh, really?
Well, yeah, man. It's, you know, it's not back to steady work yet, and it's
okay.
Things are so weird.
How is that your area, like the whole part of
my world? Immediate area is pretty good.
Okay.
Toronto is still having its issues, but I'm far enough from Toronto that it doesn't really affect me.
Okay, all right.
But Canada in general is doing a little bit better, but they're going to stage three, which means that things are going to start opening for, like, you know, restaurants for people to eat inside, and pubs,
nice.
And stuff. Well, nice, yeah, but no, not nice.
We'll see in about a month.
Exactly, we're going to see that spike. I know it's going to happen.
But if you got to stage three, you would say that they believe that the numbers are low enough to sort of
But the thing is that it doesn't mean there's not any there's still new cases.
People
happen.
Get happy
I'm not comfortable.
Fast,
I'm not comfortable until there's no new cases.
Facts.
None.
I'm the same
way.
I don't know if this is easier said than done.
Wait, let me is this you see that?
I don't want
Yeah.
That,
is that a heat map?
That's all right.
That's the staying home.
You're gonna be fine.
Hey,
little red dots there.
This is the way it should have worked out. They should have shut the country down completely. I mean, completely, and tested every single person. Now, easier said than done. I understand this, but Canada only has like 35 million people. That's it.
Oh, New York.
Yeah, basically. Canada's right. California, I think it has like 45 million. So, you know.
John said it last week. I forget. Anyway, we missed that. All right. Well, it's not happening. We're on some new measures. Trump's wearing a mask now, so everything's going to be fine.
Once.
We do this every time now. I like to knock it out of the way. I know you're dieting now, so it's probably nuts and berries, but what is your bucket list food? What is your green mile meal? If you were going to die tomorrow, what are we cooking for you today, bro?
You got to include dessert. Dessert included.
Valiant's on a dessert cake. I know
it's bad. I'm not into sweets. But
oh man, I gotta stop talking to you now.
I mean, diet or not, I don't know. I mean, I eat them, but I think like ramen in Japan, like from the stores, like yeah.
All right.
Ramen.
It's like pasta in Italy.
There you go. Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's number two totally for me. Dessert. So there we go.
All right, Trek's drinking something. Valiant, what's your food for the week?
My food for the week.
Like you said it, like you don't know the question's coming.
I'm thrown off now. I'm sorry. I kind of forget the nature of the question because we do food questions now. Track you to yours.
That's different than mine.
Well, we do ours every week. Right? We can't say our bucket list food every week.
That's what I'm saying. So you ask track first.
Okay,
come back to me.
I plan on flying to Japan to eat some ramen. Now I'm playing. I'm just piggyback a little bit. I had amazing, I know, shouts to Kat Ellis. She was up in the kitchen. She made an amazing fried rice with all kinds of vegetables and madness inside of it. That's pretty much what was good today. You know what I mean?
Okay.
Good. I'm content. Good. What about I'll give
Valiant some more time. And it's Thursday, so I felt in the spirit, and I want to say I got some Jamaican food. So I had some chicken curry with the roti, some cabbage, son. Gang, because you know what I mean? On brand. You feel me?
Oh, man.
I'm promoting even when I'm not promoting. You know what I'm saying?
I think the best thing I had all week was, and it's going to sound real basic, but tempura sweet potato.
Okay. No, I like this.
Good. That's good.
Man. And the place I get it from is like, they slice it real thin. And it is. Yeah, that was good.
I did have some plantain. I see you in the chat, code. I had some plantains too. Shout out MJ, who's moderating once again tonight. Thank you very much, sir. We appreciate you. His favorite meal is anything because he's been intermittent fasting. So we just combined two topics into one for him.
Bryzine in the chat right now?
Yeah, I was about to say shout out to Peaceful Entertainment.
Yeah, all right.
Showing a little love, my brother.
It's a whole lot of gang. Hey, since we're on
the place.
Yeah, right. Since we're on the subject of food, I do want to shout out to everybody who's in ATL right now. And I love how all these things tie together. Right now, if you look at your screen, my homie Dan Brown is having an Onikuma ramen pop-up, which ends Sunday.
There we go.
So if you've never had Dan Brown's food, he is a phenomenal chef. He's been absolutely crushing it. So he's got a pop-up. If you look right there, you can go to Facebook, Onikuma ATL, his Instagram. You can place the order. It needs to be in by Saturday at 8 p.m. and then you can pick it up on Sunday at 6 p.m. So take a look at the screen, take it with your phone, do whatever you got to do, or hit me up and I will send you the link again. But
I ain't going front, man. I'm mad at everybody in ATL right now.
So they're gluten free. The wifey got it's actually zucchini noodles they use for all the gluten free people out there. Super dope. Anyway, he's a beast in the kitchen. Everybody knows it. You see MJ in the chat right now going crazy. So
shout out to that daikon bacon, man.
Yeah, man. This is serious. It's serious. Anyway, so yeah, shout out Dan Brown. Also, he's teaming up with Bone Lick Atlanta, who makes some fantastic barbecue there right next to the Music Room, which is a legendary venue here in Atlanta. We've thrown shows. I thought it was always Music Room. You know, you're pure Atlanta, bro.
I mean, that was a long time ago.
Hey,
I left Atlanta a long time ago.
Yeah. You know? I'm saying, well, as long as I've been here, it's been music. But that's actually where Access throws a bunch of his shows. We had LTJ book him there. We had Flight there. Down in the basement of Speakeasy, we've had the Billionaire Bass Brawl there. We had LTJ book him there.
Right.
So shout out to Music Room, Bone Lick, and Dan Brown. So yeah, it's because we got it, you know. Got to rep it.
Nightlife Hillside, we trying to get there. We all positive about it. So we just going to make sure we get to the finish line some way, somehow. I'm dying to go back to ATL and hang out with the peeps out there. You know what I mean? So
yeah, man. Can't wait to get y'all back.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Good times. Good times. Good times.
So, Nick, what you been up to, man? Look, you are another one. We spoke to 12 Planet last week. Right. I spoke to 12th Planet last week, and what was really cool about having 12th on is the same reason we have was good to have you on. One, because you're the super homie, and I wanted to have you on. But mainly because you are another person who I was excited to bring in that has transitioned. I don't even want to say transition because you still do both. Someone who has gone from drum and bass, like proper drum and bass with evil intent. What is going on? You all right? I know I'm supposed to act like it didn't happen. That's a professional thing. We're just going to pretend. Like,
we want to make sure you all right, dog.
Bro,
you
know what I'm saying? We want to make sure you're okay. Are you okay?
Fine.
Yeah. You are one of the people who's transitioned from drum and bass to dubstep to trap and become one of the bass pioneers out there. So let's talk about that. Let's talk about your humble beginnings. Yes, and how this all came about. You were originally with Evil Intent. How did that come along?
Oof. All right. I mean, all right.
If
so,
you were a tree. No, just like that.
Yeah. I'm going to try to just shrink this down here.
For sure.
So out of high school, you know, I grew up playing in punk bands and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Out of high school, I went to school in Alabama. And I just didn't have anybody to play anymore with, like in terms of like playing in a band or anything like that. So, from there, I, you know, I went to a party. I saw Diesel Boy, actually. He's the first
shout out Damien.
DJ I saw. Yeah. That was probably like 97, I think, 98, in Birmingham, Alabama. Instantly was hooked. And, I met Gigantor. Shortly afterwards.
Shout out to Gigantor. Yep.
Yeah, I met him shortly afterwards in Alabama, and he showed me the ropes on production and stuff like that.
Yeah, he's a beast.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, at the time, like, he was so advanced compared to, like, anybody else that I knew that did anything. Like, you know, whether it was, like, the punk scene or, because I'd recorded albums before that, like in other people's studios, but like his setup and this and his understanding of how to track music in general. Anyway, so yeah, I met Gigantor. He showed me the ropes and we started Evil Intent in probably like 98, 99. And, you know,
that's a while ago. Woo.
Yeah. Yeah. That was the beginning of Evil Intent right there. And then we met AJ, who goes, Treasure Fingers.
Shout out the homie. ATL.
Yeah, for sure. 100%. We met him and we brought him into the fold and we just became Evil Intent, because at first it was Evil Intent Records. And it was, you know, Nick and Gigantor was what we went by. So anyway, yeah, we brought AJ in and just started Evil Intent from there. And I think our first actual proper release was like 2000, 20 years ago, which is fucking crazy.
I know, right? It's so weird, isn't it?
Say that out loud. But yeah, like 20 something years ago. That's about where I got into the drum and bass thing.
Sheesh.
Yeah, was drum and bass the first sort of thing, the entrance to
electronic music?
Yeah.
Yeah, 100%. I didn't like electronic music at all, you know, before that. I was kind of anti-electronic music, to be honest. Because I always thought it was like, and at the time, you know, being like in a punk band, I didn't like, that was the worst possible thing. Like, all I wanted was noise and speed and just like, you know what I mean? Like,
it was like that with hip hop too. Cause like I had a bunch of hip hop heads who were like, dude, what are you doing in here? And I'm like, you don't understand. They're like, I don't. You're right.
You're like, Marty, I didn't know you like techno, bro.
Techno. Bro. I was the techno MC for I don't know how long.
Everything was techno. We called everything techno.
Techno, yo.
Yeah, it was just techno. If I didn't know what it was just techno. Anyway, yeah. So I mean, that was it. Yeah, that was my intro. Was drum and bass again? Diesel Boy 100. And I've said this, like, you know, I've done interviews over the years or whatever, and I've always made it a point to give credit to him, because he changed my fucking life.
Yeah.
You know, straight up. And even outside of seeing him perform for, you know, the first DJ that I like connected with. Even outside of that, it left the club that night. Like, you know, his mix CDs, all that. Him, AK 1200, DJ Dara. American drum and, you know, like, I didn't discover UK drum and bass till after US drum and bass. And this was in a time period where, you know, US drum and bass was tiny. You know, to be honest, there was like Funkatech crew in San Francisco, had Concrete Jungle in New York. We had, like, you know, basically it was very, it was all small pockets. And then I stumbled onto like this whole world of drum and bass after that, and then jungle, and I discovered jungle and then raga and all this other shit.
I mean, while
do you remember your first like drum and bass or jungle mixtape?
The first thing I think about was being in I was riding in the car with my friend, he goes by Ricky Raw, he's in Atlanta. You guys know him. I'm sure Monty knows him.
He's got a Twitch channel on here called Party in the Future for those who want to check that out.
There you go. I remember, and I've never talked to him about this, but like we've kept up over the years. But I remember being in his car and he was playing this raga mixtape, and it was just like the hardest shit I'd ever heard in my life. And you know, again, coming from a punk background, I thought I knew what like hard shit was.
Yeah, punk is.
You know what I mean? Like, I thought I knew, but like it just had this crazy vibe and energy to it that it blew me away. So that doesn't necessarily qualify as the first mixtape, but he was playing a mixtape and it blew my mind. And then, you know, I left that hangout session. I was like, what? Like, I got to find more of this shit. Right. So, you know, if I had to like maybe like 97 Octane.
Oh, okay.
Diesel Boy.
Yeah, I remember that.
You know, like I'm not trying to like prop this dude up on this uber pedestal.
No,
here,
my
but, like,
my first mixtape was Diesel
honest,
Boy.
Like, yeah, like he was the Don, man. Like he set the standard for like how to flawlessly transition songs, which is, you know, I didn't know what DJing was really. I mean, I got it to an extent, but like to see it executed so flawlessly.
He had a presence with the set. He spoke.
No, it was Diesel. It was the same thing for me, man.
Yeah, it was more than just a presence too. He's a very technical DJ. Like he's super on point, and not for nothing. I mean, you know, we all talk about the dominance of not dominance. Excuse me. The integral part the Philadelphia scene had, and Platinum was a part of that, and he was the head honcho there. Like he was the face of that. Like Planet of the Drums, like when he went out with Jay Messinian. Like Damien, I've also defended him even after those days because of the plain simple fact that that man spent buku money making those mixtapes. He would call up the movie guy who did all the sound, like, and do these Peter Collin, do all these crazy intros for free. Like, you know,
like 611.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, Monty, you're from Philly. Like, mm-hmm. I mean, the 611 mix was another one. I mean, it's kind of hand in hand with the 97 Octane.
I mean, for me, it goes back to, you know, because I live in Buffalo, and back when he was in Pittsburgh, and he came up in 95. And I remember the first time I heard it, and I didn't get it. It was this big Armory rave, and he played, and I was like, I don't know about this. And I think it was like a few weeks after that, and I heard Witness of Strength, and I was like, oh, okay. Right. And that tape, I mean, I wore the shit out of that tape. Another tape. There's two tapes by Starchild. When he still lived in Pittsburgh. And like one was Jazz Excursions and the other was Simple Pleasures. And through those three tapes, it was like this, like every sound in drum and bass at the time. Mm. And like I just wore those tapes out. Yeah. Like it just completely changed my musical outlook completely.
Yeah. I haven't found anything since then. Like nothing.
No.
I've loved tons of genres of music since then, but nothing will ever capture like what I felt when I first heard drum and bass. Nothing.
No.
And I don't see anything taking that over, because I think that a lot of it's like the magic of youth, you know, just kind of like, you know, just hearing something new for the first time that just didn't make sense to me, but I loved it. Right?
No, I still feel that way, man. It's like I love hip hop. I love R&B. I love all kinds of music, and it's apparent that we keep dabbing in all these different styles. But there's something about drum and bass. Just for me, it's different for everyone. For me, at this point, in the beginning, it was just a melting pot of different sounds from all over the place that could be thrown in, whatever. Now the science that goes into creating drum and bass is mind-boggling to me. That's right. And that's what I fell in love with. Now that I've always told people it's an acquired taste, and once you get that taste, once you sip that fine champagne, you can't go back to, you know what I mean. You can appreciate.
Real quick, Monty, to say your mic is a little hot.
All right, I'll turn me down.
Yeah, just so you know.
I just like being
loud. I'm sorry to break it up.
No, that's fine. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, picking up on what you're just saying right there, though, like, I feel like other genres, like, have kind of caught up to that. Because, you know, you said the science that goes into a drum and bass track, right? Mm-hmm. And I feel like it was doing that then in the 90s.
Way back in the day, yeah.
You know what I mean? But now I feel like dubstep, other genres, I don't want to like say dubstep in particular, but it's the first, like, there is this, like, this crazy science, and I feel like there's a connection to be made between what's happening now, you know, with dubstep and like these kind of more advanced bass music genres, and what was happening back then. I'm not sure how to make that connection completely.
I have a question that I think will do this, and I know it's a question that the two of them want to ask, and it's I've been teasing this moment for the last 4 weeks or so, last four episodes. We have had numerous conversations about the change from drum and bass to dubstep, what that moment was sonically, how you feel about it. You've got a very different outlook. Everyone talks about the economy and things and 9/11 and yada yada yada, but there's sonically, what was the moment to you that changed this whole game?
Sonically?
Yeah. We talk about pendulum,
like the transition. Okay, I just want to make sure I get the question. So for me, I would take it back to whatever influenced Ed Rush and Optical in the late 90s. All right, so like, let's start there, because they would need to answer this question for me.
And that could happen.
I don't you know, I'm not sure exactly. I'm sure that their influences were the people just before them, just like every other music producer, right?
For sure.
Like, you know, you're maybe not every, but you know what I'm saying. Like, so let's start with Ed Rush and Optical is my point, right? So let's start with Ed Rush and Optical and move forward. Who did they influence that made a huge impact in dance music as a whole? Pendulum?
Mm-hmm.
Probably.
Noisia?
Probably.
100%.
100%, yeah. There's no problem. 100%. Yeah.
So I guess what I'm getting at is, you know, like, though Pendulum and Noisia alone, they made such an impact on drum and bass. And it's easy to say that now, but like at the time, like the first time I heard Vault by Pendulum, and not just me, like everybody who was around at that time that heard Vault, it blew our fucking minds. Like, there was nothing like it ever that we had heard within drum and bass, not just musically but sonically. Like, it took like Bad Company, Ed Rush and Optical, and it flipped it on its head and gave it this like weird personality, and the sound design was out of this fucking world. And then after them came Noisia, who we, you know, I don't need to say anything about Noisia.
Yeah.
So, okay, now keep moving past that, and like, who did they influence? Like, you know, Skrillex. Let's just start with Skrillex, because, you know, one of his huge influences was Noisia and Skrillex. What did that lead to? You know, and you can follow the rabbit hole here, and you can follow the thread for as long as you want, but I guess my point is I personally feel that all modern day sound design within, you know, bass music, dubstep, whatever it is, trap, even like all sorts of different genres, it stems from Ed Rush and Optical, and it stems from whoever influenced at Russian Optical before them. You know what I mean? Does that make sense? You following along?
1,000%.
What kind of trap are we talking about? Are we talking about dirty southern trap?
No, no, I was talking about like EDM trap.
But okay,
that's an afterthought.
That's a whole other conversation.
Like, wait a second.
Let's drop the trap thing because that was just
no. I get what you're saying.
Point being, I think my main point is that like, and let's jump back to Pendulum real quick. The concept of a mix down back then was like, okay, I got to mix the track down and get it out. But they took it and they ran with it and they made
scientific
rock and roll mix down. Like, you know, Rob Swire, like the head engineer of Pendulum, like that guy he's a genius. And he had so much experience beforehand, you know, engineering rock music, which by the way, just to stop real quick, shout out Gigantor, because that's where his background was as well. He had this like comprehensive understanding of how to take a snare drum and make it hit you over the fucking head. You know, they want the kick drum to hit you in the chest.
Yeah, and that's actually the thing I recognized immediately is almost, and I don't mean this by the way as a diss. I actually mean it. I identified the sound right away, but like their drums were mixed down the way like White Snake's drums were.
Yeah,
like absolutely. That snare was like a fucking cannon. There was a lot of compression on it, but at the same time, it brought it like to the fore of the mix. Everything was like really forward, and then if you contrast that with like the 9 from Bad Company, which is like, technically speaking, was really rough.
Totally.
But it was one of those things. It was like this big sea change in like the dynamics of like what drums.
See, like once you go into that, like then we start getting into like vibe versus mix. And that's a whole other conversation.
For sure.
You know, and I think there's validity in both. Like, and I think the perfect song is a blending.
For sure.
Is a blending of the two, absolutely.
Nevertheless, like just to kind of close out the thought, I think what my point is just like, you know, if Pendulum hadn't reinvented the snare drum and drum and bass, or the kick drum and drum, or the mix down, there would be no Skrillex. There wouldn't be anything that came afterwards because they changed the game, period.
I remember listening to the Vault. I remember the first, like the first little bit when that was out, thinking to myself, "This sounds different. This is like, I didn't know how to put the." It was funny at the time. The first time I said something, I was like, "This sounds like it belongs on Monday Night Football." And when I said it, it sounded like I was trying to say this is poppy commercial, whatever. But I was like, "No, this has a different appeal to it and a clean sonic sound that we've not heard before." Because, like you said, vibe versus mixdown, a lot of it was the vibe. It's the grunginess of it, the dirtiness of the mix sounded fucking sick. When drum and bass was too clean, sometimes it sounded like shit. So they had a fine way to make a clean mix down that still hit hard, and it was just
the music was good.
Yeah.
The music was good, the mix was good. It was a controversial tune, and what's crazy to me is that that tune was controversial because it had a swing step.
Clown step.
Yeah, which is insane to me by today's standards that was controversial. You know what I mean? Like, things have gotten so crazy now. Like, you can get away with so much. But the only reason you can get away with so much is because they took that risk back then. And that's what I'm getting at is like, you know what I mean? What, like,
but I don't see the. All right, so like, back to Ed Rush and Optical, like golden time, hard as a mofo, unforeseen meteor that struck everybody on the western side of the world, especially, you know, Canada was crazy about it, right? I'm thinking, like, if we're talking about like a sound desk, I always felt that there was this, if I can explain it right, like this 80s slam that was updated within what was going on afterwards. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm trying to find a good example of it, but there's like a certain thing that when it was explained, like when it came out, that it was just like, you heard it, but it hit you even harder. If I could figure something, I'm sorry, guys. I'm blanking out.
No, you're good.
What was the figure of the right, you know what I mean?
Another part to me, too, is, I'm sorry to cut you off real quick, and then we'll go. No, part, it was also around a similar time when drum and bass in America was going through a bit of a change because things got really hard and really dark and
that was our fault.
Not our fault. Yeah, I mean,
we got a little bit dark and a little bit.
I don't feel like you guys went too dark.
you were a little bit.
But I mean, there were much. Look, at the end of the day, I had a conversation with this track earlier. Is I loved all drum. I've traveled with Bookum. I've traveled with Dylan. So like, is no.
Right.
There were times Dylan would be like, "You're the only person who understands me, understand my set," and it's because it was just amen breaks literally all over the place.
Right.
When that became the standard. That's when Pendulum kind of came in and gave you that same vibe, but made it dance floor.
Right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So like,
it was just as hard. You know what I mean? Right. Like impact. Like that. Yeah, I mean, that's the thing about the mix sound. Sorry, I'm gonna finish this thought. But I guess what I'm getting at is just like the evolution of the mix down. You know, it was an afterthought in the past. I mean, you know, drum and bass was the first genre, in my opinion. First genre within EDM, electronic dance music at the time, because it was not EDM. But you know what I mean? It was the first genre in dance music that I feel like really took pride in the mixdown.
Right.
And they took...
Dude, you can't say that.
What else before like the late 90s took pride in the mixdowns?
New York.
That's all
I mean, if you listen to like years of like house and tech house,
right.
and like deep techno and stuff like that, mixdowns were serious business. But the problem is though, is a lot of it was you weren't including like bass, snare, drums. I mean, like drum and bass was actually very rock oriented in that sense. It was almost like in many ways it was like basic, in the fact that you took like a full drum kit,
right,
within like the composition of a drum and bass tune. There was like hats, bass, snare, other percussion. In techno, you had like one kick, and to say that like mixdown wasn't important, I disagree.
That's not what I'm
saying.
Mixdown
was important.
That is
it got
what I
more
said.
Advanced maybe under drum and bass.
That's what I said.
Okay. Yeah,
that's what I said. So I'm saying like it was the first genre to take it and move it to the next level and to take it seriously in regards. Yeah, like you're right, 100%, because when you're not working with a full drum kit, like you said, because that's actually a really good point, because the introduction of the snare drum, like the progression of engineering in terms of snares, like look around online and type in like producer meme. Mm-hmm. on Google, and it's going to be about a snare drum.
Your snare sounds like shit, bro. Yeah,
you know what I mean? And that wasn't a thing until kind of like Pendulum.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then Noisia took it that's my point. It's like you can, if you take a step back and you've seen it happen, you can see this thing just kind of like a straight line. You can connect it. You can connect everything. And I
believe the origins of that too none of us can talk today. Is basically ingrained in the DNA of drum and bass. It's just like how the thing even started from taking samples and stretching them out to belief and like twisting them in all different ways with analog sounds. It's like I don't think anyone outside of maybe sampled hip hop took that as seriously as drum and bass did, which is, you know, to me is just the UK cousin of hip hop in the first place. So
it's pretty much they say the same.
I'm not saying anything. It's not a hot take. We're just keeping it a buck. I don't think those two genres themselves took that type of manipulation to a higher degree, and I think drum and bass actually took it, you know, 10 levels farther, to be perfectly honest.
I agree. I think sampling, sound design, everything. I guess what I'm getting at is like drum and bass to me has always been a genre that it stands apart from all the other ones within the electronic realm. And that's I'm not trying to take away from any other genre at all.
They'll tell you. Like,
yeah.
Well, do you know how many house heads who I've met and they're like, dude, I don't know how you guys do that. That shit's crazy.
Yeah.
And you're like, we know.
Drum and bass is all very crude drum and bass. Like, you know, if you go to like 94, 95, 96 into tech step in particular, like the tech step era, like it was so crude and it sounds like shit. But that's Best Buy today's standards. At the time, it was mind-blowing.
It was blowing, and we just wanted everything loud and screechy that part of the era, I believe. And we wanted it a bit dirty, so we wanted a little bit of static and a little bit of scratch in there.
Everyone
and
always
the UK was like, "What the hell are you guys doing to our music?"
I feel like the nerd factor in drum and bass has always been much higher than any other genre.
Agreed,
for
agreed.
Who's denying that though?
I'm
proud of that shit.
Shout out Dogs on Acid.
I think like the nerd factor, I think like dubplate culture, like advancing things as fast as it did, all led to that. And then when digital became much more viable in terms of production, it was only a matter of time before people like Pendulum came along and said, "Hey, we're going to elevate this to like rocket science," and made it sound just completely different. Like you couldn't mix a Pendulum tune on vinyl out of a tune from like 3 or 4 years beforehand without there being a huge difference in you had to know what you were doing for there to be a seamless mix, because it just sounded quieter, flatter, like it was
sonics.
A totally different thing. Yeah,
we were fighting with digital at that time. A lot of people wanted an analog sound within the music, and then some people found a proper medium. I don't know how they did it, but there was a few out there that just found a way to just balance enough warmth with enough pop.
Right. And, that's still kind of like the goal.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm only speaking personally, but I mean, that's something I'm always going to be dealing with digital interfaces. Everything's going to be digital in my life from moving forward. There's, you know, so trying to retain that kind of analog sound is a goal.
Yeah.
And I think most producers that have been around for a while, they recognize how powerful analog can be in terms of production. So it's definitely like a never ending quest.
For someone who works with you regularly, I think one of the like craziest things I say to you sometimes is like, "What did you actually play that?" And you're like, "Nah, I did it all in the computer." And that's like a huge thing to me. It's like something you made in the computer that sounds so organic. You know what I mean? So it's crazy, and it's something I think all producers should strive for, and it's not easy to do. I mean, I hold you in high regard because you can. There are plenty who try, but that's not necessarily how it goes. Another thing I like to say, flipping back to the saying that you guys played really dark music, I didn't take it as too dark. You have to remember, like, a lot of those tunes at the time, like Correct Cops, Corrupt Cops, and Street Knowledge, you know what I mean, like those were like pivotal moments. And not just that, but you guys took those tunes and you came with an image with it as well, like even down to the Ludacris projects and things like that. You guys had a whole motif. You know, shout out to Mayhem and like all the cats out there that were just like, like put a really like a different vibe and came with your own sound. It was almost like I don't know if it was necessarily like a movement because a lot of you were based out of the South, maybe. Like
I think it was a bunch of influences. I mean, first of all, you know, Evil Intent was a trio, right? So there's a lot of influences that are going into that melting pot right there, and we happen to share the same influences for the most part, but you know, AJ Treasure Fingers, he happened to be this really good with manipulating audio in SoundForge, which was the program we were using to do glitches at the time. So he kind of led us into that era of Evil Intent, of like really glitchy shit, and then I kind of like learned it from him, and so did Gigantor, obviously. And I think that has a lot to do with it, you know what I mean? Like the shift in sound was down to influences like Aphex Twin, Square Pusher, like all these IDM artists that they were doing jungle at 200 BPM with glitchy, crazy snares, and we loved it. And we were like, it wasn't a conscious decision of let's make drum and bass that does that. It
you
was
just did it.
Let's just do this because we love it. You know what I mean?
It worked.
And I think the Amen drum kit was just the go-to for us.
Go-to.
If you don't like amens, like
what the hell?
I don't know. Like we don't have much to talk about. Like that's the drum
greatest
kit of all time. Period.
There's like,
greatest
like
it transcends
ever.
Drum and bass.
There's a whole documentary coming out. I can't wait to see.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh man! So talk about the Ludacris. How did the Ludacris project come about? Because that was people back there. It's in the chat, and I've been around too long enough to know that there are still many people asking about it.
There's a whole lot of Ludacris going on in the chats right now.
Well, all right. Well, I think first and foremost, I should say Ludacris was the most fun I've ever had making music. Period. And I say making music. Like mixing music is more what I should say, because we did do our own production on top of everything, both mixes that we released, but I call them mixes and they were actually 60 minute productions. What I mean, like I wish that I still had the Ableton files for that so I could just show you a screenshot. I mean, it was an hour of just madness, you know. We'd have one like 80s song right here, and then like 50 layers of other random things happening underneath it, and then it would go on to 1 minute, track two, track three. It was just that for 60 minutes straight. Anyway, how did it come about is that I think I had so the first Ludacris release was called Bang Fest. The first 2 minutes of that mix is just something I kind of threw together. And then Jake, Kill the Noise, also known as E1 in the drum and bass game, he was visiting in LA. He had moved to LA at that point. And he was just like, this is cool, blah, blah, blah. We start talking about turning it into something more. And that was it. You know, once Jake got involved in it, like, he just took, you know, anybody who knows E1.
Jake, I was going to say, shout out Kill the Noise, dude.
He's a fucking genius. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, it doesn't take much. If he likes something, he's going to run with it, and he's going to do it better than you, period. You know, he's better than me. Like, say that. He's such a great producer, musician, and he's so smart in the way and thoughtful in the way that
I was going to say, and a nice guy.
Well, yeah, but I mean thoughtful in the way that he puts his music together. Like, he doesn't settle ever. Like, he'll never settle for something until this is what I want. And that's, like, you know, that's admirable. That's how it started, you know. Like, we just pitched a couple files back and forth, and that was it. And then we made Bang Fest, the first mix, and it did well. And then the next one the next release we did after that was definitely more involved in terms of like the production aspect. Like, we really went in on that shit. Like, big time.
I'm sorry, I'm reading the comments and people are losing their minds.
Yeah. They're trying to coax another one out of you guys.
Look.
And he and I have talked about it many times about doing another one, but the problem is lack of material. And granted, 10 years has passed, I think, probably since our last release. There's plenty of material, but the thing about Ludacris is that we kept reaching back to like the 60s, 70s, 80s, and then fusing it with modern music. But it's like we kind of ran out of 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s music to match. At the end of the day, yes, we could come up with a new mix. Every time it's come up, we try to figure out what would it be. You know, like, are we trying to make original music? I don't, like, even that's see not really what I mean? What there's doing. There's a bit of a dilemma.
I get it.
Because it's like, what, you know, Jake is doing Kill the Noise. I was doing Bro Safari hardcore. So it was kind of like, how do we carve out time to do something that's basically like just for fun? You know what I mean? And in retrospect now, like, we had those conversations a couple years ago. In retrospect now, I would say, well, because it's fun. Like, why would we not do it?
That's right? The only answer I was about to say. Like,
right. Yeah, right. But at the time, you know, when you got a tour schedule, you have a release schedule, you have this, you have that. It's kind of hard to be like, all right, well, I'm going to dedicate like 6 months of work to to making a mashup mix. You know what I mean? Like, that we don't know what's going to happen with.
Going to happen afterwards.
But, you know, I would love to make more Ludacris. So everybody
blow up his Twitter, blow up Jake's Twitter right now.
I'm ready. Kill the Noise. And, I think if we did more Ludacris, it would have to be in the vein of the first stuff we did. Like, there's no point on making our own music. Like, that's not the point of Ludacris, right? It was just kind of like fun and a mashup of everything we ever loved. Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
Shout out Ash in the chat.
Big up Jake, man. I knew him from around Rochester. Was only 45 minutes away from Buffalo.
Right, I was gonna say, because you said earlier you lived in Buffalo, and I was gonna say Rochester. Like, so, I spent a lot of time eating garbage plates up in
garbage plates.
And by the way, Jake, back when he used to tag team in the day with Cody, and I remember I used to run this little night at a sushi bar, and it was like, I think like drum and bass and whatever else, I don't know. And this is like after, long after Screw Up had come out, and like Ewan had been blowing up as a producer. He still came out and played my stupid little night for like $50. And he was always a really good dude.
He was Jake is the man. Love him.
Yeah, for sure.
He's one of my favorite people in the world.
He's got one of the best Twitter accounts on the planet.
agreed. For
sure. So Bust the Chops is up in the chats, and he asks the biggest question of the night.
I was not going to ask this question, but here it is.
What's the significance?
Of the name?
Blow the secret.
Sorry to disappoint, but there's no, like, I literally, look, okay, at the time I was living in Los Angeles, Evil Intent was kind of holding on. Like, we weren't getting booked. Electro was getting really popular at the time. Mashup was getting real popular at the time. And I was writing like glitchy, like right at the beginning of the dubstep movement, basically, when everybody was doing like kind of deep 808 and just really like chill, deep dubstep stuff. I liked it, but I wanted to do it glitchy, you know, like Evil Intent style, because that's what I was coming out of. So I made like four or five songs that were dubstep, glitch, weirdness, and I wanted to start a MySpace page for it. I said MySpace.
That's 2 weeks in a row.
Right. I wanted to start a MySpace page for it, and so I needed a name, and the name Bro Safari came from, I think, Rastafari Bro Safari, but it didn't happen like that. Right? It wasn't like, just like
I looked at a can and it said brother, and then I looked at a poster and it says Safari.
Literally, I shit you not. I was sitting at my computer thinking, like, what the fuck am I? I was like, it's a name your MySpace page, and I couldn't figure it out. And I just, that's what came to my head. It was Rastafari, Bro Safari, Bro Safari. And I typed it out and I clicked accept, enter. And then I started my MySpace page. And then I reached out to a graphic designer and he made the logo of the Bro Safari face.
Oh, wow.
And then he sent it to me and I used it. And then Drew Best from, everybody knows Drew.
Smog
was throwing shows and they wanted to book me to play a show. And I was like, all right. There you go. Here's my logo.
I'm laughing my ass off because I've toured with this fool for years now, and his question comes up every time, and the interviewer is always mad disappointed. It's not embarrassing. I think it's great. I think it's the best.
I mean, that's it. It's that simple. I just, you know, I needed
the best. The best moment. Shit often comes without thinking. So whatever.
Yeah. You know. My name's Armani Rain.
You're inherently a genius, Nick.
Right. There we go. I'll take it.
You said when you used to make music for Bro Safari. Valiant is trying to leave us as much as possible today. I don't know what's going on.
That answer was not satisfactory.
He was like, that's it. I'm done. that's the way you came up with the name. I'm out. All right, so let's talk about Bro Safari and the future of Bro Safari, what you're doing right now, because I know you put out a very beautiful video explaining you were exploring different options. Before we get to there, on the tail end of Bro Safari, you worked on a fantastic project with UFO called Clockwork. And I know the significance of that and what that album meant to you. To the both of you, and I was wondering if you wanted to talk about that and what's going on with Bro Safari right now.
Because
they kind of tie into each other.
In terms of Clockwork, look, at the end of the day, like Clockwork for me, I was really proud of that record. and it didn't do very well. It didn't do well in terms of what other people expected, I think, right? Ed UFO and I had done an album beforehand, Animal, which did great. But this one didn't perform as well. And at the time, I was not in the mental space to deal with disappointment. Like, if I'm just being like real about it, like, and you know, a lackluster like feeling in general behind it kind of like set me back, and I was like, all right, I need to take a breather here. Not to get all like
fucking... No.
I've left the violin in the back,
so. Yeah, but you know, I mean, I think what it is, like, there's a lot more to it though at the same time, you know, like I spent, like, Monty, you were with me, man. Like,
absolutely.
We spent so many years on the road just grinding, and I wasn't really working on much music because it took over my life.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, like, I just, the grind of travel, I had no energy to make music. I had no inspiration to make music. I just couldn't. And, you know, everybody's different. But for me,
sorry, guys,
I think I just hit a point with Clockwork where I was so proud of it, and I was like, this is different. This doesn't sound like anything anybody else has been putting out, but nobody seemed to give a shit. And that's fine. And I accept it, especially now. I'm totally fine with it now. But at the moment, it kind of like, it hurt, like on a personal level in a little bit. So that's kind of what started me, you know, started with me like deciding to take a step back. It wasn't the fact that it wasn't well received. It was the fact that I just, you know, I sunk so much effort into a release, and it didn't feel like it mattered.
You know what I mean? So here's, and if you don't mind me interjecting here, here's the thing. I'm going to talk about two separate points you just put on, and the reason why we got along, the reason why we became such a brotherhood on stage. Off stage, you know, I mean, you're my fucking brother, and you know that, and it'll, you know, for that's friendship shit. As far as a working relationship between DJ and MC, you might not know how many times behind closed doors I would explain to people how much you put into a DJ set. I was like, Nick's not just going up there and mixing tunes and little drops in here. Like, this man spends weeks on basically reproducing every track on that we play.
Right.
It's not like there's a tune here and a tune there. He takes pieces from everybody, has them send them. You put so much time and effort into every single one of those sets, and it showed. Like, we went ham. We used to make the jokes all the time. My wife would be like, you guys are basically doing workouts on stage. Like, when we first started like working together, we literally just told people, hey, like, today's workout. Like, we would literally go so hard. We both decided to stop wearing jeans. We were like, we're only wearing tennis sneakers from now on, and like workout clothes, because the intent was, we're going to punch you in the mouth from the second it starts to the second we leave. And no one understands how much time and effort went into that. And we did that over and over and over, and like, you poured that and it was taking away. So then when you come back and you've got to pour that into another set, and you don't have time to work on music, and you had to take a step back to do that. So then when you finally sat down and made this Clockwork album, which, for anyone in the chat who hasn't listened to that album, the fact that wasn't well received is mind-boggling to me. And it is one of the most sonically advanced, cohesive projects in EDM, and electronic music I've heard in a long time. And I don't, you can say I'm fucking biased or whatever you want to do, but if you go listen to it, and not snippets of it, a song is cool, this song is cool, that people love ET Fingers, people love Numb, listen to it from beginning to end, the same way you would listen to Kendrick's Good Kid, Mad City. It's a fucking movie. And like, it was amazing how many respected producers that I know listened to that album and was like, this is the greatest thing I've ever heard. And it tripped us all out when it didn't get the critical acclaim or whatever of the public, for whatever reason. Partly because I think most people were expecting more trap, like bro safari stuff, right. And this was like so many other levels above that. Like it was just it I don't know, man. All I can say is just go listen to it from beginning to end and sit down and experience it, you know.
I want to say that's something I think within the with all artists in general, that when you have like when you come up with like these hits and they become hits, it is pretty much in the machine of business to keep that same kind of identity flowing. And then you want to do something like, it's been plenty of times where I thought records that I've done on stage was like, rawr! And then you do it and you put, and then everybody's just like, oh, that's cool. What?
Yeah.
And then there's this one tune that you may not really even give a care about, and the whole room is on fire. I just wanted to say that because I'm in the club, guys.
And we're all artists. That's the thing, is we're not here for cookie cutter bullshit.
Unique struggle, yeah.
Right. You know what I'm saying? I wanted to say that it doesn't take away from the effort,
for sure,
and the energy and the creativity that was put into it. Because what happens is eventually people catch on down the line. It just down the line sucks.
That's kind of what I was going to say, is that, you know, like I don't want to harp on the fact that it wasn't well received, right, like by standards at the time, because no, it wasn't, but I'm fine with that now, you know, at the time though, that's like, I want to make sure that I signify that, like, it was a moment in time for me, and now we're years past it. So now I look back and I'm nothing but proud of it. And I know that people will go listen to it at some point. Like every day, there's somebody out there that probably stumbles across it, right? And that's all that matters now.
That's all that matters,
right?
I know it's a stretch, man, but look, Paul's Boutique was trashed when it came out.
Right.
It sold shit for the longest time. Yes. And most people consider it their best album. So, yes.
Agreed.
You know, obviously, hindsight is a real gift, but, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I mean, you know, it's just at the moment, just kind of, I don't know, it threw me off. And I think but again, it was indicative of more problems that were like building over time. Like you said, Monty, like we were playing so much. Like it became a point where it was just like, come on, like this is brutal. Like I'm not ever sleeping, and I'm not saying that to complain or whatever, but like
no, we were having a blast while we were playing.
Yeah, exactly. It's the, you know, it's the 22 hours that surround that set that always sucks for a DJ and a, you know, MC or whoever's traveling and touring and shit.
Monty, how you kept that voice together, man?
Back to back. I don't even.
Years of cigarettes and.
Let me ask you a question, Monty.
Who's kidding?
Of all the shows that we play together, like, what is your takeaway? What if you know what I'm saying? Like we played so many shows together. Like for you, what is the one thing that stands out to you? Whether it's a moment or just a feeling that you take from it. Sorry.
No. It's
a broad question.
It's a big question too. It's just like, wow. You know, I two things. Like, if I had to turn this camera off and like speak to you in the sense that we haven't spoken before because we're just friends and no friends don't normally talk about this shit, but like, I learned a lot from you. I learned a lot about how to conduct myself going through these sets. I learned about the time and effort we put into the sets. I always considered myself a student of the game of whatever genre and DJ I was emceeing for, and learning that DJ and finding their tendencies to do things and all that. But we took it, in my opinion, to another level, and we did it day in and day out with Aunt Compromise. And I think I learned the biggest thing out of that is that you can be treated in a certain way as well. I've spoken very highly about how much you've taken care of me in a time that I needed it the most. So the Bro Safari sets for me, like, we joked all the time as people were like, yo, man, like, you know, MJ says it all the time. It's like, oh, man, he's part of Bro Safari. And I would joke and I say, we're all Bro Safari, because that's how you made everyone feel. From everybody in your scumbags chat to the people who love you, who respect you as a person, your production, as a father that you would consistently put online with showing your son and your family. Like, that shit's different. And we put that on stage. We brought Elliot on stage. There was a different vibe to everything we did. And we poured our fucking hearts out every single time to the bitter end, whether there were 600 or 10,000 people there, it didn't matter, dude. Like, we put everything we had in those. Shout out Mike Brady, who was on the road with us on a regular basis. It was a different type of camaraderie, you know what I'm saying? Like, a real family vibe that I will never forget.
Yeah.
And I appreciate it. So, bigger than just a musical moment. It's just like, I love you, dude. We talk all the time. Like,
I don't know. I was just thinking about it, man. Because, like, I was thinking about that from my perspective, like, coming onto the podcast. What is a moment for me that just, like, stands out? And I realized that there wasn't one moment. There wasn't one show, even though I could name some shows that were great.
A few, yeah.
But what it was for me is, like, you know, like, every time that we would play a set, you and I would always lock up beforehand and look each other in the eye and dap each other up, fucking do our little secret handshakes. And that, like, to me, is, like, that's what I took from the whole Bro Safari experience, honestly. It's just, like, this, like exactly what you point out, the camaraderie of it. Like, touring and just, like, kind of, you know, it kind of transcends music a little bit, I guess.
Totally.
You know what I'm saying? And that's totally off topic of what we're talking about, but
no, it was funny because in the beginning, like, I've respected you so much as a person. When we first got involved, my whole thing was, like, I want to make sure that I continue to carry the torch that my homie Sharpness had beforehand, to keep that level of, like, you know what I'm saying, to make sure that this runs smooth. And that was my main concern. But then when we got into it and, like, I really saw how things were going, and you're right, it was a ritual thing with us. Like, we take two shots of Fireball every single time. Like, we go outside, we do the dap. We'd, like, I have the stretch. I have videos of Ash from Phoenix making fun of me. Cause, like, it was, like, that was our, a thing. It was religion to us. You know what I mean? It's like, even when we were like, and we took it seriously. Like, if one thing, little thing went wrong, we both were pissed for the rest of the night. Like, it ruined the whole day.
That was like the transition from, like, getting old to just being old. I'm just an old man now. I'm just like, all right, whatever.
You know,
transition phase, like, yeah,
man. It was, I can't name one minute moment because there are so many from the from the bait to Denver.
Again, sorry, I didn't mean to throw it off. Like, for what?
No,
you
man.
I just like that.
There's no plan. We just talking. This is it.
I was thinking about it earlier. Like, you know, I'm curious because I was trying to think of it for me. You know what I mean? And I thought, I wonder what it is for you.
It was big, man. You made me tear up on my podcast and shit. Dick.
T. What were you gonna say?
No, sorry. I was just going to say that just all I had to do was look on Instagram and look at the pictures and know that there was a lot of fun being had over the years. I'd be like, yo, who is body rocking with? God damn, look at the size of that crowd. They're losing their minds. Then the next day, damn, another one? Oh, my God, what's going on? So I already knew I was saying up, and it was always Bro Safari, Bro Safari, Bro. I'm like, all right, so it's Imani and Bro Safari now. God damn, this must be it. This looks beautiful. You guys look happy, and the crowd looks electric.
Dude,
for those crazy ones, I feel, you know.
Crazy, crazy, crazy moments, man. I couldn't even begin. We'd probably ask Mike. Mike will give a better answer of actual
Mike
parties.
Has a much different answer.
So wait a minute. Did you guys document any of this video stuff that, you know, from some of these shows? Or am I missing that?
Yeah, is there a DVD that could be put out from all this?
I mean, they could...
DVD, listen to
me.
DVD.
Yes. Just on that note, we are making a DVD and passing them shits out. Right out to Trump.
Holy shit.
DVD.
Hey, Jesus, Nick, I want to ask you, like, you know, you came from a punk background and stuff like that. So, like, what are, like, the two, what did you take away from punk in terms of there's a couple things. Like, in terms of possibly the sonic influence that you got out of punk and stuff like that. Actually, and then also what you took out of it in terms of, like, ethos, philosophy,
right,
stuff
easy,
like that.
Easy answer. Work ethic and, like, DIY work ethic. Mm-hmm. And in terms of, like, sonically, speed. Speed and intensity. All right, so, like, punk rock is built on this DIY ethic. Everybody who's listened to punk knows this. And with Evil Intent, we sold mixtapes out of the trunk of our car. You know what I mean? We pressed all our own vinyl.
DVDs.
We paid. We didn't. You know what I mean? We pressed, made our own DVDs. no, but you know what I'm saying? Like, it was VHS. It was all in house. Like, we didn't set out like, all right, we need to get signed to a label. It's like, all right, well, we'll start our own label because nobody's going to fucking sign us. Mm. And so that's what we did. And that's how we built our name. And then, you know, sonically, it's just the punk rock speed. And I just loved high intensity music.
It's hard to ask this kind of question, but, like, your experience in punk rock up until you kind of hit the drum bass wall, uh-huh, was what? Like, what sort of scene were you into? Like, what kind of bands were
Everything.
You into? Like, that kind of thing.
Like, I got introduced to punk music when I was in fourth grade, and the first two bands that I can throw out there was Dead Kennedys and the Dead Milkmen.
Dead Kennedys, whoa.
Yeah, and the Dead Milkmen. It was like this it was whatever my sister was listening to at the time, because she was older than me and she loved that stuff. And Fugazi, Minor Threat.
Oh, Fugazi was
Misfits.
So fucking big for me, dude.
Yeah, Fugazi, it's still to this day, you know, listen to
Repeat. It was like that sort of documentary about Fugazi, and, like,
I don't think I did, actually.
Just how fucking DIY they were. It was like DIY to an absurd
right.
level. I mean, like, everything was absurd. Like, there's no way a band could make a living off of what they were doing. But at the same time, it was also simultaneously so inspiring. You're like, yes, I'm going to go out and play for absolutely nothing, because that's the right thing to do.
Right.
And you know, that kind of
stuff. Zines, like, you know, like fanzines, things like that. Like, just like that, like, 90s kind of culture of punk rock. That's where all of me comes from. Everything, 100%. So, yeah, I mean, you know, like you're asking for examples, it went, you know, like, from the bands that I stated, and then kind of into high school, where it was like NOFX, Propagandhi, Fat Records, like all these, like
Tracking Out Quiet and shit. Like,
you see what I mean?
Right.
You see what I mean? Like, it starts going in from like drum and bass.
Right.
Like, it was the same thing to me. It was the same, like, momentum and intensity.
There are a lot of punks in drum and bass. Like, a lot of them.
Exactly. So, no, I mean, that's 100% easy. Like, that's the answer. Like, easy. It's just like.
So, it wasn't no peeking in the room while you were in the other room, right? When you was like, yo, what's going on in here? Oh, this is crazy.
No.
None of that going on.
Nope.
Not that simple anymore in life, guys. So, you know, the real deal. But, yeah, you know. But, I guess my thing is, when did Evil Intent knew that the bar was raised? Like, when did you guys know that, here we go, this is takeoff?
It was when Chris Renegade at Renegade Hardware.
Talk about it.
He reached out and he's like, I like your guys' music. I want to put, and then he said, hey, look, Clayton at Hardware is allowing me to start a new label under Renegade Hardware called Barcode. And I want to release some of your songs. I want to release Corrupt Cops and Crack Rocks. I think that was right. And I might have it wrong, and if I am, sorry. But around that, it was roughly in that time period where all of the sudden the UK gave a shit. we weren't searching for their approval at any point, but once they did, I mean, like, I, you know, Future Cut, Usual Suspects, all the entire Renegade Hardware lineup for me were gods. Tech Itch, like, which I guess wasn't Renegade Hardware, but you know what I mean? Like, all, like, just these, like, they were the gods. Ink and Loxy, like, I could keep going. You know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
All of them. They were gods. They were gods, straight up. So when Renegade Hardware, in any capacity, even if it was a new label, barcode, we were just like, holy shit. My dream getting into drum and bass was to get a song on a Diesel Boy mix CD and to release an EP on Renegade Hardware. Boom. Nailed both of them. And the only way that the Hardware EP happened was because we met Chris Renegade and he was young blood. You know what I mean? That's something to consider. It's like Clayton had Hardware running, but he brought in Chris Renegade as like an A&R or whatever he was doing at the time, right? And so for Chris to bring us in, like, forever grateful, you know, like we got brought into the fold, so to speak, and got an EP released on Renegade Hardware. And that's when, like, personally, I was like, this, like, we, like, we're doing this shit. Like, we're, like, I'm buying, like, I see a white label written Evil Intent, like a white label promo in Rewind Records in Atlanta. You know what I mean? Which is where I went to shop for records, or Satellite Records in Atlanta, whatever it is. Like I saw my own shit, like right there in front of my
freaked
eyes.
Freaked out a little bit, right? Like, oh, look at this. This is happening.
Yeah, yeah. So that was it. That was the moment. Yeah, for sure.
It's always a great feeling.
And getting recognition from the OGs. You know what I mean? It genuinely meant a lot.
I like how we always talk about how that doesn't matter, but it really did, like, a lot. My whole career was basically, you know what the best part about it was, the fact that we didn't seek it. Because I didn't seek to MC for Goldie. I didn't seek to MC for whoever. It was just like, I'm just going to do what. Also, a lot of that is because when I first started MCing, I was told no a lot. So it was like, okay, you know, no, like dead ass. Like when I told the story many a times when I went to Miami that same weekend I MC'd for Goldie, that was the last day I was there. The entire week before that, it was Henry going, yo, you should put my boy on. And they'd be like, no, like, you know what I mean? So it was just, and it's always been like that back in Philly. But once you started to get those cosigns, like, yeah, no. He's fucking all right. You're like, ah. Like, ah. I mean, whatever.
I mean, I remember our first show in Philly at, we never played Platinum, by the way. But Platinum was the, like, that was it.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
we
yeah.
never got to play it before they stopped doing shows there. But we did go to a show there. We, our first show as Evil Intent ever was at Direct Drive New York with
Cliff. Yeah. There we go. Scene. Yeah,
seen Pish Posh.
Pish Posh,
wow. Gang,
Pish
gang.
Posh. So Pish Posh was actually the first guy that like really like noticed us in the US. Yeah, yeah. Pish Posh, Wally was the man. Like he is to this day. Like
to this day, bro.
I wish that I could catch up with him. Yeah. So
he's a good brother, yeah.
Yeah, he booked us for our first show ever, which was Direct Drive, and he was like, "Look, you guys can play before the opening act. You gotta get here. We can't pay you anything." So we got in the car from Atlanta. We drove 16 hours straight to New York. We got out. We played our show. We sold, or we handed out. We didn't sell. We handed out 50 mix CDs of all original music. Got in the car, drove straight home, all in one shot. It's like round trip.
18 hours up and 18 hours back, huh?
Yeah, back to Atlanta. Wow. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Lord.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. Crazy.
Those yeah, I want to say
that's what I call paying your dues, though, right? Like,
yeah,
you know, like that's some of my best memories. Like, you know, we had to get in a car and drive to New York to play for an hour, and then go back. You know what I mean? There was no money involved. Like, and I guess the concept of paying your dues is different now, I think. You know, because everything's different.
It's all different now.
Branding and like how far you reach on social media and this and that. But like, there was no social media then.
Mm-mm. You were
literally had to build a following in your hometown and then hope to expand outwards into other states, like regional following. Like Evil Intent, they have a regional following. You know, like, all right, we got a regional following. How do we expand that? You know, and it wasn't a conscious conversation, but you know what I'm saying, like.
Yeah,
that's in retrospect. That's how it was.
DMBLF tour was 9 dudes in a 12-seater van driving across the U.S.
Yeah, exactly.
Like,
yeah,
Yeah.
I know.
Shit was not fun.
It just got all quiet, like we're all
Like,
yeah,
oh shit, he's right.
Yeah. Think about our road stories right now.
We had a blast. We had a blast. Everybody looked back.
Yeah, like, whoa, yeah.
Wow. It's one of those things that in Europe and England, I don't think anyone really can understand what people in North America, especially the United States, went through when it came to playing gigs, going to raves, because you'd be like driving 12 hours. It was normal to drive 12 hours. Go to a gig or go to a rave or whatever, when in the UK you might have 5 raves within a couple of hours driving distance.
Yeah.
And like we just don't have that here. Like we'd drive down to New York City or down to Baltimore all the time. That was like at least 7 or 8 hours in the car. Baltimore, like 9. You know what I mean? Kind of thing was just the normal thing. Like, and that's like the nature of the beast. That's the nature of the beast in the United States.
But that's passion, right?
It's absolutely. I always laugh because they always say that too. It's like, yeah, man, we drove from here. We did three shows in a night. And I'm like, and I've been there. I've actually done with Craze. We did 3 shows in a night and it was crazy. Because in that amount of time that we did those shows, it took us just to drive to Pittsburgh. It was just like, we used to drive through the mountains for 9 hours just to go to a gig. Like, man, those days are crazy. I'm so glad we don't do that no more.
Well, exactly, though. I mean, it's true and it's funny, but I mean, it's like that. I feel like that is a, you know, it's a big,
like 5 dudes cramped up in the back like this for hours.
Bro, I got bad stories about it. Look, let me be fair. The DMBLF tour was super fire. We had such a blast and it was an experience. I have so many stories to tell, but like if I could. I would love to tell the story about a good friend of ours, Kevin Focus, who like we were driving through a freaking rainstorm and the belt on the side that was holding all our luggage on the top kept tapping the thing.
No.
And for like 2 hours while we're trying to
just
ignore
came up in the chat.
Hey, Focus, and he was so upset. Like, can anybody hear that? And we just got angry. I just got angry. I love him to death. He knows I can tell the story. I was just like, if you don't shut up about the damp, it was just like that kind of like 9 dudes in a van for hours upon hours.
It's an
experience, you know what I mean? Like we stopped in Mobile, Alabama, at the side of a road. I won't go any further with that. But yeah, man, those days were crazy. That's why I don't get too mad nowadays about the airport situation back when we used to fly planes and leave our state.
My God, we're spoiled.
And
Uber now, you know what I'm saying? All this wasn't around back then.
Yeah, man, it was just, you know, I'll take the cattle over the 9-hour drive to a gig any day. But
hell
yeah. Hey man, you sent me a bunch of tunes.
Me?
Yeah. I like it. The other guy.
He's like, oh, I checked out. I'm sorry, what?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean, all right, so I sent you 3. That's
you
did. Not a bunch.
You sent me 3. We do have a lot of tunes to play. We're going to start a little earlier than normal. We normally like 2 from you and then 1 from us, yada, yada, yada. But actually, we're doing it a little different because, like I said last week, we were going to start doing more than just playing our tunes.
We're going to get our own picks.
Yeah, let's get into, let's see, what do I have here first?
What are you going to play? You want me to give me any background on this?
I'm definitely going to get a little background from you. So, I'm going to play this one first, actually, because it's I've been waiting for the world to hear this tune.
What?
Talking about the Clockwork album that I thought was Sonic. I had the pleasure of hearing the tunes that didn't make it onto the Clockwork album.
Uh-oh.
So, this was one of them. Would you like to explain?
Is it You Can?
Yes.
Yeah, You Can. All right, so... One thing that didn't get expressed was that UFO is a fucking
monster
OG dawn of American drum and bass.
Respect, yeah.
Right? Like Funkatech crew in general, like
oh my God, State, they were
Juju, UFO. Like when I was starting to DJ before I produced, I was buying UFO records, right? So like to me, working with UFO was like a privilege, right? So the fact that he and I wrote multiple albums together and this and that, you know what I mean? Like, I love Ed. Like, so he's like genuinely like a brother to me. I have to give him his proper, you know, respect here. If we're talking about drum and bass and we haven't really gone into Ed.
Yeah.
So Ed is, he's a genius, especially with drum and bass, man. Like he has a way with production that just elevates it. Every time he drops a fucking amen loop in his tune or a fucking think break in his tune, like he does it with such precision and intention that like if I were to say like my number one most underrated producer, it would probably be UFO. And
I think a lot of people would agree with that as well. You know what I
so
mean?
All that being said, this song right here, you can it was just a song that didn't make it onto the Clockwork album, but we just wanted to make a drum and bass tune, but we didn't want to just make a song that started and stopped. We wanted a song that like a drum and bass song that kind of touched on multiple eras of drum and bass.
Oh,
yo, let me explain to you that I cannot express enough how happy I am to finally play this tune in front of people. I'm glad that I got the honor to do so. I'm sure a couple people have heard it outside of here, obviously, but yo, I'm gonna just go ahead and play it.
Yeah.
This tune is ridiculously fire. So here it is, You Kim, Bro Safari, UFO. You guys can mute your shit and click on Twitch, and then you can hear the tune too. And I will return back after these messages. Check it out. Live and direct, Roti and Poutine, you're with the special guest, Bro Safari. Track MC, Valiant MC, myself and Monty Rain. This thing here, You Can... Team. Special guest, Bro Safari. Sheesh. Y'all ain't even ready. Yo, hold up. No, man. I've been trying to tell you. I almost pulled it up. I almost rewound that shit. It's like no matter what style of drum and bass you listen to, it's for you.
I was enjoying it all the way to the bathroom.
Yo, that tune, bro, that thing there is wild.
I appreciate that, y'all.
Like,
and thanks to the chat, I saw that. I appreciate you guys. Let me mute the stream. Yeah, like, this is something that Ed and I have been talking about, is like, how do we maybe get these tunes out that didn't make the album? And not just that, like, there's, we have, y'all, we have so much unreleased music, UFO and I, like 40 plus, like, wow, pretty much finished tracks that just never came out, because we set the standard for ourselves. But, you know, and now listening to it after, you know, a couple of years have passed, like, I hear that and I'm like, yeah, we should just put this shit out.
It's fucking fire.
Why would we not?
I mean, out of curiosity, that fit in right within a certain era of, well, like, I could hear, was that a guitar lick, or is that some, like, voice that's going?
Yeah, it's a voice, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that is in my head, it won't leave right now.
I'm allowed to ask what she's actually saying, because here's the funny thing. Every time,
I'm not going
to
tell you, so don't bother.
Damn it. We play this game all the time, because Nick is the master, Ed too, of taking samples and making them sound.
I will never tell you.
He's had things that, there are tunes out there right now, I'm not going to point out which ones they are, of people singing in there. And I'm like, what are they saying? And he's like, that's an instrument. And I'm like, you motherfucker. Like,
yeah, but that's what I'm saying. It comes off like a guitar lick. Like somebody's like hitting.
Bro.
Right.
You know.
And that's always the goal, you know, with like producing with vocals for me personally. Like I've always made an effort. Like even with Evil Intent, you know, like I it first started with like glitching vocals. Street Knowledge is a good example. You know what I mean? Just like making tunes that like you take a vocal and you just cut it up and glitch it, and mangle it, and make it sound like something that it wasn't before. And that's like something, that's like a strength for me in production. You know, like I lack in other areas, but that's one where I really try to embrace.
Brett said, just drop it in Bandcamp.
It's just that every time I look down to the comments, there is something new that I've never seen before.
Chat is bugging today. I'm not. Normally, I read off some of that, but I'm not doing that today. Y'all on some shit today.
Oh, God.
So, let's see. What else we got here?
Oh, hey, by the way, the chat asked before that tune dropped if there's any announced timeline as to when your thing with Inks is going to be dropping.
Sorry, wait. Say that again?
When you're, I guess you, a couple people asked about a release with Binks that you got coming up.
Yeah. Hold on. There's a reason why I'm holding that. All right.
Just asking when.
So there's one you sent, this Ned John. I don't know what this is.
Oh, all right. So wait, if you're going to play this, let me give some context. This, you know, if we're talking about like me and UFO, like unreleased stuff, the one I sent you, it's weird. All right. So like whoever in chat, like it's weird, but I think weird is good.
Suddenly.
I think weird is better than good. I think everything needs to be a little bit weird, you know, not everything, but like
not everything.
I embrace that shit. And I think I want you to play this tune and I want to see what the chat thinks, because this is a song that we did within a day. Like we did this in a day.
Okay. And to appease the masses, I'm playing the Binks joint next. There is a Binks joint we are going to play.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But let's be talking about this right now.
This tune right here, like I feel like, all right, so you and UFO and I have talked about starting a new project that isn't Bro Safari and UFO, and it's just something new. We haven't named
Brew
it.
Brew FO. There we go.
No.
Let's be clear. I don't care about your jokes. The answer is no.
Brofo. UF Bro.
Brofo. That's what we name all of our files, is Brofo. But no. It's weird. It's weird. It's different. But it's jungle mixed with, I don't know.
I'm just gonna play it.
Like some weird
it's
shit.
It's literally called Ned03 Experiment. So
yeah,
I've never heard
the song is called Experiment. It's just.
Yeah, we got it. We're just gonna play it.
Do it. Yep.
Let's just go. Well, mute up, fellas, and get ready for the ride.
ROTI and Poutine exclusive, Bro Safari, UFO, MC Armani Rain, track Valiant.
Turn it up.
like that. Bro, alright. Roti and Poutine. Exclusive business, this one's experiment. Y'all think chat? The chat was flipping.
So like let me like the goal of that wasn't like a dance floor. That this is the thing, no. Is like, you know, there's this like conception where every song you make has to be like something you play on a dance floor, right? Which is insane to me. But nevertheless, like that is not like your reflection of drum and bass. That's like jungle. You know what I mean? And like that's something that Ed, UFO, and I are like trying to kind of reconnect with, is like the era before drum and bass, before the Ed Rush and Opticals, to kind of bring it full circle, like what influenced Ed Rush and Optical was that era, right? Obviously, I mean, jungle, like breaks, samples, it's kind of like trying to like find our own voice within that era and like bring it to 2020, which is crazy because that was early 90s, you know.
It's fun. It sounds like the stuff that I was even listening to before I even knew what drum and bass was. So it was like, when you finally walked into a party, like,
where it was just kind of like, it just had this like, I don't even know how to explain the vibe or the sound, but it's just like break beats, you know what I mean? Like breaks and bass. Breaks and bass.
Manix, like, kind of shit. Yeah,
you know, like absolutely. Taking that and then kind of fusing it with like this weird like Aphex Twin aesthetic and I don't know. Anyway, before you play Binks thing, can I get a bathroom break? Sorry.
Sure.
I got a piss, man.
That man's been holding it in denim. You got to give
him a screen. Hit him with the screen, you know what I mean? Hey, after these messages, we'll be right back.
I just want to say to everybody up in the room, you guys are live, and I'm the one with the Bacardi in my hand, but you guys are way liver than me, and I'm enjoying it. You guys are making this much more of a great day. Thank you for coming through, checking us out. You know we're going to be doing this every Thursday, and we're going to try to line up the weeks properly for y'all, because we just got people wanting to be a part of it, as well as they're really liking the show. So, you know, your guys' support encourages us to really keep this game going. And we are like almost 10, what are we, almost 10 episodes almost, right? Almost
something like that, man. We want
all
you
together, I think so. Something
yeah,
like that.
And we got some people in the future too. We got some things coming up. Also, you guys will be happy to know the YouTube channel will be in effect very soon. It is up and ready. We just finished rendering the Goldie episode. We will put that up. Also, we will be putting up the audio in podcast form, so you can put it in your pocket and take it with you. So we're moving things to another. That's right,
bitches. We'll be on Spotify soon.
Ah!
Oh!
But yeah, man, if you guys stick around, we've got plenty more music to come. I wanted to save Binks until now for a multitude of reasons. And it's funny because I don't want to talk too... Don't call me pocket money. Don't do that.
I just wanted to say that you're doing a good job of saving Binks right now, just so you understand that.
I don't think people understand how highly I think of Binks. So... Now that Nick's back, I can get into it. I saved Binks for a number of reasons, because I'm going to play a tune that Nick gave me. I'm going to play a tune that the three of us made together that Nick didn't know I was going to play, but me and Binks talked about it, and it's not your decision. So
I like it.
I tell people all the time, when it comes to sound design, there are two people in Scrum, Binks and Prisms, who are on this crazy level for two completely different reasons. Prisms is so varied in the things he can do at, I don't even remember how old he is. Binks, go ahead. I don't know if you guys want to put that on blast like that. But Prisms is a young kid whose potential is crazily through the ceiling. Binks is also one of the most hungriest, humble people I've met in my life. If you've ever sat down and talked to Binks for more than 10 minutes, you've learned something. You feel better about your soul. He told me to eat better and sent me a 15-page PDF on how I can do that better.
I actually read that shit and I started implementing it.
I'm trying to tell you that
PDF you got.
Just hit Binks up. He'll make you your own. He is 100% all about making your spirit better. He is a good person to be around, to talk to. I am so happy he's in my life. And if we're going to talk about music, on a level of, I call him a new wave of nausea. Like, he's got a particular sound design creativity vision that most people I don't see out of a lot of people nowadays. So I needed to big him up a lot before I just play a random tune.
Before you play anything, I just like want to point out that Binks has the best snare drums in the game. Period. And I've said this to him many times over text.
That's a large statement.
I don't know what it is about this dude. Right. I don't know. Like, he's just got this like sonic. Like, his ears are tuned into this frequency where he just nails the snare drums every time.
If you haven't checked out Bing stuff, go check it out. And I'm telling you now, it's not like he's got things that ain't out yet that are just crazy.
It isn't like, just his snare drums. No. But it kind of, again, full circle, like I was talking earlier about snare drums, like how that's like the focus for every, it's like the meme. But like, I remember hearing Binks for the first time. Well, actually, no, the first time I heard Binks was with Pyramid Juke back in the day.
Shout out, say word, talk about it.
Yeah, you know what I mean? So like, I used to play their tunes as Bro Safari, like their trap stuff. And then he just cut, they disappeared off my radar for a while, and then Binks popped back up, and I was like, oh shit, you're part of Pyramid Juke? Okay, now it makes sense. And anyway, long story short, like, Binks is the future. Like, his tunes are fucking crazy. So if you're not up on Binks,
the same dude who I did the tune Manifest that I played for you guys way back in the day, that everybody was like, yo, it's just crazy, Binks produced that. He also did the remix for 38 Special on my EP. Right. He's insane. He's got crazy tunes out. He's got a song called Hope that's out. Like, numerous things I could point out. Orion, I still think, is a fucking banger. Like, dude, he's and the shit that he's got coming is insane. But you can't even blow his head up because he's just a humble dude. Like, we talk about all this shit all you want, and he's still going to be like, it's not a big deal.
He and I talk, like, pretty frequently.
Yes, about, just all, but don't FaceTime me with the shirt off, dog. That's all I'm trying to say.
Keep your shirt on for the FaceTimes. But he and I talk all the time, and it increasingly it becomes more about our own personal well-being. And yeah. I love it. I love him because he's such a good, like, we gas each other up. Like, when I work out in the daytime, like, I'll send him like my stats for like my calories burned or whatever. He'll be like, yeah, you fucking killed it. Like, I'm going to go kill it now. I'm like, yeah, get it, dude. You know what I mean? Like, he's such a good, like, just wholesome
dude. Good soul, man. And it's rare to see it. So anyway, introduce this tune between the two of you.
Me? So this tune right here. All right. So Binks and I came together to do a 4-song EP. It's due, I think, October. If I'm wrong, I'm sorry. This is the lead track, track one off of the EP. And in my opinion, it's my favorite. This tune grabs...
I like all of them.
It grabs influences from drum and bass, which you'll probably hear in the intro in particular. But it's just like, you know, I think one thing for me personally was like working with him on this song. It felt liberating to kind of just do my thing, like whatever I was feeling at the time, because this was after I took a break from DJing and I just wanted to make music. I didn't care about
it. Was the perfect timing. It was it was so good.
The timing is like, I didn't care about making a banger. I just wanted to make some like good shit. Like that was it. So, you know, having him there to talk me through it, like on my end, because I was very unsure about things I was doing, he would gas me up. And that was huge. Like in particular, like, you know, in the second drop of the song you're about to hear, like I played a guitar and I was very like, oh, should I play a guitar in a trap song or whatever this song is? And you know, he just gassed me up throughout the entire process. And I think I'd like to think I did the same for him. So I don't know. I mean, that's about it. I don't have much to say.
Here's the tune. Alrighty.
What's the name of the tune?
It's called track one.
Okay.
No, I'm kidding.
It's called Revival.
Revival. Okay. We're here.
Mute yourselves. There we go. Crazy, crazy.
Can you turn it up at all? It's a little quiet on the screen.
Nope, we're at 100. Let me check. Roti and Poutine. Brand new, forthcoming, Road Safari, Binks. Shout out Binks one time. Road Safari, this one's called Revival. You're listening to Roti and Poutine. twitch.tv/Armani Rain. Track MC, the valued MC. Vibes. Same. crazy, 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 crazy tune. That's called Revival, forthcoming from Bro Safari and Binks. Yeah, man, that thing, that's a summer jam right there. That's a winter jam. So you can curl up next to somebody, you know?
Curl up mode.
Yeah, that's my
don't pull
mode.
Up, curl up.
Although, you know, we have four tunes total. Again, I think it comes out in October. Binks and Binks is in the chat. Am I wrong?
Nick went off on the guitar.
Binks is in there. Binks is in there.
Yeah, you know. Yeah.
Big shout out.
I'm pretty sure it's October ish.
Sick. What's it coming out on, Dino? Is that settled?
I do, but I don't know details. Like, okay, leave it. Something you got to understand is that I've completely removed myself from anything to do with anything that's important. I'm living in my bubble.
I know.
Yeah.
I guess I'm like, I know, but the world doesn't. So yeah, it was good for you to say. My bad.
It's on a good proper label that'll give it like distribution and notoriety.
For sure. That track right there was really good. Like,
thank you, man. I don't even know what to say.
Like that was like a surprise of the moment, just because.
Thank you.
Like, I kind of expected, but I didn't know what to expect. And then when it hit, it was like, oh. Okay.
Something completely, yeah.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
Because you get that real metalhead.
I couldn't ask for anything more.
Yeah.
Like, that.
Yeah.
That's, thank you.
Well arranged. Well, everything that's in there belongs in there. And yeah, that was fly. That was absolutely fly. Thank y'all for that, for sure.
Boys are sick, man. I'm trying to tell you.
Wait, Binks said in the chat, or sorry, in the he said no release date yet.
Oh yeah, they're holding it back. They gotta get it right. Make sure they get it right, Binks. Make sure they get it right, bro.
Right, not October. I thought it was sooner. I don't know, maybe I'm wrong. COVID, you know.
This next joint is from the three of us, because just as much as I wanted those two to work together. I gotta get a tune from these two together for me before I die. And it's not the only one. We've got a few more, but whatever. We won't talk about that. It ended up being called 1418. The reason for that is because of the intro you hear. I'm pretty sure, I'm almost positive I never played on this podcast. The intro is a flashback to when I was a child, of when I made this intro, and I used to live at 1418 Willison Street in Chester, Pennsylvania. So it was kind of like, you'll see when we knock it out, but they absolutely destroyed this beat. It's funny because when I play it against my other tunes, it sounds so much louder and brighter. This is like the sound design between these two super producers is fucking insane. So this is 1418, otherwise to them known as Whoa, and I'm excited to play it for y'all. Whoa wasn't gonna work. We wasn't doing it. I'm not, you know. So here we go.
Oh, Whoa.
It's not called Whoa. It's called 1418. Oh, it was originally called Whoa, but then they made a dance, and I had to be like, nah, we're not doing that. Here it is.
Yo, yeah, I've been home. All right, you okay? The door was open. Yeah, I'm fine.
Oh, that's fine. Yeah, no, I've been home. I'm just writing.
I had a hunger. Nights I would stare out my window and wonder if I could ever do more than just better. I never had doubt in my head. I was younger. I came up from under fatherless summers. Four winter spring where the same coming from us. Mama will hustle, no discussing needed. Trust me, we was always even, all or none of. See, that was the moment, in case you ain't noticed. The realest shit I ever learned was that killer be killed in this moment. In time, I should chill, cause the coldest in line doesn't melt when he's focused. Cause hell when I wasn't, heaven was bussing. Dishing out listening.
Exclusive.
By the dozens, the heavy
shoulders
didn't care. I was fussing. All they heard was, hold up, let's get where we going. Come on, man.
Sheesh.
Abuse, confuse the clues that few would seem to choose to lose. I can't call it. Detect neglect from true perspective. You just reckless. Yeah, I know all this. The brain breathes easy to skin. Black and blue only showed up in the pen. I was bleeding for you then. Once you in it, cause the air hit it. I would never dare live it twice. So I buried it with it. I mean, on God, I'm going to turn the page. Know my face could help someone who thinks they got no one to say. They got no one to change. They wait. Knowing it's okay to run with the whole stage. Or show them the road pain before me from those the same stories and tell them it's no shame. Or worry the game is made for us like, go live dangerous. That's who hangs with us. The insane to them. We just move. Why you hating? Take it slow. Scared of the ops? No, I am ho. The last drag on like Kenny.
ROTI and Poutine. Track. Valiant.
No, we don't see the side to
new Lenny show. Back to the boss and attacks and the frost. Let's react to the scars so many grow. I had a vision. Me and my dreams had a head-on collision. That out of body told me that nobody is gonna understand my hardest decisions. Of course, when I listened, something was missing. Silence was deafening, subtitles glitching. Why that perspective would label me reckless? I swear that I came out that way feeling different. Yeah, I'm on a new one. I see every nuance. Yeah, from the bottom through and through on here. Fought tooth and nail polish through on clear. I don't know winning that grew on fear. Not with projected, but always respected. Cause who I connect with will not disappear. Truth from the diagram, check my Venn diagram. All of my motives on similar tiers. Like damn that, get it right, same truth. Different light space, they be giving like energy was missed despite. Have them in they feel it cause they can see the mirror type. Being unfamiliar is really what they fear in life. If it's had fishing lacks, all of the precise strokes. Let them feed this and that, these were never nice folks. Look why I started, you'll see bigger fish to fry. People depending on me, never miss the vibe. Oh my, my whole life I've been on my own. Holding down what I own and know as this. Which I defend like a good O-line. O-line showing these times I've been a gold mine. Go find somebody else and let that hope shine. You ain't gonna hold me down, homie, we both lying to ourselves. My mental health ain't really about that. Scan at the ops, no, I am ho. The last drag on like Kenny glows. She's let me, whoa. Better way to cop 2 pennies, no. We don't see the side too many show. Back to the boss, set attacks in the frost. Let's react to the scars, so many grow.
So that's the new one. It's called 1418. That is produced by Bro Safari and Binks. Man, they push me, man. They push me, so.
Yeah.
I hope y'all feeling that.
That's just hard, man. Oh, I haven't heard that minute. It's been like 2 months since I heard it.
Yeah, man, quiet as kept. I've been
stacking
tunes. Like, people think I'm just sitting around doing nothing, playing video games all day.
We know you ain't doing nothing, brother. You ain't doing nothing.
I keep leaking.
There's a lot of hard work going on. That nobody wants to talk about. But there's a man working extra hard right now.
Nah, man, yep. I'm chilling.
I got to give it up to you on that one, Monty. That was an exciting really exciting. Dynasty. Can't wait for that to come out, honestly.
I appreciate it.
You know, see how, you know, right now the comments are going wild, so it's well deserved.
It's funny. These two, man, I had to, we've got other stuff too, and it's been many a times. Like, these two producers, along with Mayhem too, I would send tunes and be like, nah, that ain't it. I respect that. You know what I mean? Like, they make me push my pen. And we got it to a point, too. Like, there are tunes where I would just get a little too lyrical. Or there were times they would let me be that. And, like, they just, whatever was appropriate for the tune. Working these two guys has really, like, especially now in this day and age of, like, coming up with something that means something, you know what I mean? They've really helped me push my pen to a different way than I've been rapping in the past. So, you know, shout out to both of these guys, man. We've got other stuff in the tuck. So, yeah, looking forward to putting that out.
We need to do an Amani interview one day on here, Fallon. We got to figure it out one day.
I mean,
Amani, how do you breathe?
We got one.
That's what Amani doesn't do. We know that he doesn't do this one thing during all this. Is he doesn't breathe.
my fat ass can't even do that shit right now.
I didn't load it into here, but Nick and I have something very special that I want to put out first before I put anything else. I'm working on the video right now, and that's the only thing holding it back, and there's no label, no nothing. We're just going to put it out for the world to have. It's important to both of us dearly, and I can't wait. We talked about playing it today, but...
I mean, it's on you. If you want to play it, you can play it, man.
Wow, man, y'all can't be talking about things and then debating.
I mean, the thing is, the song, it touches on so many different things that it feels like a video element is required.
Okay. Right,
to an extent. However, I mean, the song is powerful on its own. We just felt like out the gate, like it just kind of, like, if it had a video component, it would make it more powerful. You know, impact is what we're always looking for, right? But
I see that
it's on you, Monty. If you want to play it out, I got no problem.
I'll tell you what, it's not loaded in here, so what I'll do is we'll get to the other tunes We'll get to the other tunes. We're at 12 o'clock already. Start on it. I don't have it in the computer. You know how this goes. So I'm going to try
Elizabeth,
to load it up.
I'm coming, Elizabeth.
Look, man, look. We're going to play the other tunes that y'all brought on, and I'm going to try to load it up in the process. If the shit don't happen.
A few moments later.
Yeah, that one's called To The Few. It's produced by the legend right there, Bro Safari. We will be putting that out. And, yeah.
I need to smoke some weed after that racket, but we cool.
Yeah.
It gets a little intense.
It's a little intense.
Dig deep.
It's a little bit.
But, I mean, you know, the video, everything coming soon.
Very, very soon.
Looking forward. Absolutely forward.
Hey, yo, absolutely. I just want to say thank you guys for having
me. Yo, thank you for coming by, bro.
Yeah, I personally needed this. I needed something.
For sure. I think it's really cool, too, because you don't normally do things like this. So it was important. You know what I mean? I thank you for doing it. I'm glad you had a good time.
I had a good time hanging out with you guys.
I think we're also lucky to have the time to have conversations out in the open. So, you know, there's a lot of people who are just busy on the road, such as yourself, who don't really get these breakdown moments. And now that we have a breakdown moment, why not show another side to yourself? Right. So people could be like, okay, all right. You know what I mean?
Totally.
Well, I really, really appreciate it, man. Yeah, all you guys.
Man, we appreciate you.
We appreciate you coming, man.
Cool.
So thank you to everybody in the chat. Thank you, MJ, for moderating. Once again, you are a Don.
MJ, you are a Don.
Shout out, MJ.
Sugar Brad, Ashley, one of the most dedicated
soldiers Ashley?
Out there. Yeah, yeah.
Ashley big ups. Phoenix, Ashley?
No, the other hand. Wait.
Oh, how many Ashleys was going on here?
We know two. They're both from Arizona, ain't they? Where are you from, Ash?
Two Ashleys from Arizona. You gonna wait?
Yeah, I'm gonna wait. She deserves that respect, goddammit.
Yeah.
Hell yeah, I'm waiting.
Well, Wallace shows up on the lag real quick. Big shouts to everybody else that came through. My man, Lieutenant Reed, up here representing, you know what I mean? Buster Chops up here leaving some comments. Subconscious says he's gonna leave you a folder, Armani.
New for Mexico, that. That's what it
there
was.
We
all right,
there we go. There
that
we
was
go.
Similar.
Right.
Yeah. Both Ashes are fantastic people and die hard. I've sent her clothes. She's cop clothes as soon as I got it. She's always been supportive of everything we've done, and I appreciate her for being in the chat. So I have no problem shouting her out on the podcast. Everybody else, man, we love y'all too. We appreciate y'all coming through. Sugar Brat was good. Everybody came through. Kali, I see you.
Big love, Sugar Brat, number one.
I know. Binks is in the chat. Everybody came through. Binks. Anyway, we are way over time. So I just want to thank y'all. Like I said, take care of your mental health. If you can't do it yourself, please reach out to somebody and to help with you. And we love every single one of y'all. I have more shirts. Go to ArmaniRings.com. Here you go. Look, check
Nick,
out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Love
thank
you, man.
Guys.
Much love, bro.
Appreciate it.
Valiant, Armani, track.
There goes your theme music right there.